By all appearances, this seems to be an unremarkable road. A couple of intersections, cars, pedestrians, and a small triangular green space in the middle of a large urban area. But what is remarkable about this place is what is not there. And what is not there is this statue. Actually, the statue is not all that far away, residing in a military cemetery only 1.8 kilometers southeast. However, the statue once sat along this road. It is the bronze soldier of Tallinn, and its removal set off a bizarre chain of events that ultimately made Estonia a small Eastern European country with a population barely over 1.3 million, on par with the Memphis, Tennessee metropolitan area, a cybersecurity titan, consistently ranking in the top five of cybersecurity measures, and one that all of its NATO partners rely on to protect the Western world from digital Russian incursions, never mind one that they will ask to put Russia in the dark should World War III start. Today, we look not only at the story of how this statue turned Estonia into a cybersecurity superpower, but also how Estonia's newfound digital capability may deter another invasion of Europe. Prelude, World War II. We can trace the origins of the saga to a long time ago, in an empire far, far away from where I am now recording these words. A war was brewing on the European continent, and the Soviet Union and Nazi Germany made a secret pact to divide Eastern Europe. On September 1st, 1939, Adolf Hitler made good on his promise and invaded Poland. World War II had begun. Estonia, only recently having become independent after World War I ended, declared itself neutral in the hope that its more powerful neighbors would leave it alone. But those hopes would not last long. As Poland was staring down invasions to its east and its west, a Polish submarine sought safe harbor at an Estonian port on September 14th. Despite Estonian neutrality, authorities detained the vessel, likely due to implicit German or Soviet threats regarding what would happen if Estonia did not comply. Nevertheless, the Polish sub managed to escape its Estonian confinement on September 18th, and it would eventually resurface near Scotland before serving alongside the Royal Navy. Moscow, still allied with Germany at this point, was not amused. Stalin issued an ultimatum. Estonia could either host Soviet military bases or go to war with its much larger neighbor. Not seeing a better alternative, Estonia bowed to Moscow's demand and permitted Soviet troops to cross the border. But it was only a Soviet stepping stone. Fast forward to June 17, 1940. Paris had just fallen to the Nazis, and France was in the process of surrendering. Stalin, recognizing that no one was there to stop him, not the least the already neutered Estonians, decided that it was time to properly invade the country. 4 days later, it was his. Of course, that earlier pact between Nazi Germany and the Soviet Union was a sham. On June 22, 1941, 1 year and 1 day after the Soviet Union captured Estonia, Germany invaded the Soviet Union. Stalin ordered a scorched earth policy to slow the Nazi advance. He therefore ordered the creation of extermination battalions to destroy anything valuable that would otherwise be left behind. Estonian partisans joined their Latvian and Lithuanian colleagues to try to stop these Soviet extermination battalions, to some degree of success. They earned the nickname Forest Friars for the cover that they operated out of. But things were not looking good on the other side either. The Nazis advanced through Estonia between September and December. Estonians had hoped that they would regain independence. What they discovered is that one imperial power had replaced another. Operation Barbarossa did not go as Hitler had planned, however. The offensive stalled as Germany moved further east, where strained supply lines and the cold weather took their toll. That allowed the Soviet Union to eventually begin to push back. Germany would only remain in control of Estonia until 1944. As the Nazis retreated, Estonian independence movements rose up once again, only to be crushed by the Red Army's return. The statue is cast. Victory in Russia's Near Abroad served as the backdrop for what is called the Bronze Soldier of Tallinn. By the Kremlin's telling of the story, the workers of Estonia grew tired of their oppressive government and saw the Red Army as liberators, twice over. To fit that propaganda narrative, Soviet troops erected a monument soon after recapturing Tallinn to commemorate their collective sacrifices made, and called the area Liberator's Square, even though the park is clearly a triangle. It was also the reason that the Soviet Union held Victory Day parades, the same tradition that Putin reconstituted in our current era. The defeat of Nazi Germany should be a common value celebration for everyone involved. But Estonians did not see it that way. They just swapped one evil fascist oppressor with an evil communist oppressor. What they really wanted was their government from the interwar period back. Basic symbols of Estonia, like the triple lion, disappeared from the public light. Some Estonians buried their flags to avoid the wrath of Soviet officials, but with secret hopes to one day dig them up and hoist them once again. Thus, when the Soviet authorities erected the first iteration of the monument, a short blue pyramid made of wood with a red star atop it, Estonians were not impressed. On May 8, 1946, two teenage girls blew it up. They were promptly sent to the gulag. The next year, the Soviets replaced it with the bronze statue that we all now know. And that is about where things stood for the next 44 years. The Estonian Soviet Socialist Republic would be under Moscow's control until 1991, and the bronze statue was not going anywhere. But the Soviet Union eventually fell apart, of course. And at long last, Estonia was independent once again. However, the country's political problems did not go away overnight. As the Russia-Ukraine war has taught everyone, Soviet policies relocated ethnic Russians into the constituent republics. Even today, a fifth of Estonians are ethnic Russians. This created some tension. Ethnic Estonians viewed the display as a reminder of the Soviet Union's oppression. Ethnic Russians, many of whom descended from people who actually believed in the Soviet system, saw it as part of their heritage. Or at least enough did to cause political problems, anyway. It did not help that the Soviets had buried about a dozen fallen soldiers at the site, making it a sensitive issue aside from what the statue itself represented. And thus, it just remained at the triangularly shaped square. As is standard for contentious politics, the status quo had prevailed. The statue's removal. Fast forwarding 16 years, the incoming Estonian government was ready for a change. Besides not being something to celebrate, it was also an inappropriate place to bury the war dead. This was a busy city block, not a place of quiet reflection. However, discussions about removing the statue predictably upset ethnic Russians who were Estonian citizens. Large protests broke out on the streets, and counter-protesters came out to match. 57 were injured. One Russian citizen, who was living in Estonia as a permanent resident, was stabbed and died. Estonia held roundtables to try to resolve tensions through dialogue. One of the bombers of the original statue, who survived the gulag and was still alive come 2007, took part. But on April 27th, the government decided that it needed to move the statue, and fast, before the protests got worse. 3 days later, it found a new home at the Defense Forces Cemetery of Tallinn. Estonia held a commemoration for the statue on May 8th, notably the day that Europe celebrates victory in Europe, and notably not May 9th, the day that Russia celebrates the end of the Great Patriotic War. The difference is a quirk of time zones, but the active choice to celebrate on one day or another also reflects the politics of post-Soviet states. Anyway, the statue remains a contentious political topic today. When I visited the cemetery in December 2025, there were plenty of fresh flowers laid on the soldier's helmet and at its base, and I saw a couple of people bow to it as they passed by. However, take a closer look at the statue. Do you see how the star on the left does not match the rest of the statue's coloration? That is because, 2 months after Putin announced the launch of the special military operation in Ukraine, someone filed it down in protest. What we see now is a replacement. In any case, That is the story of the Bronze Soldier of Tallinn. And if this were a video specifically about the statue, then it would be time for us to go home. Books, like, share, and subscribe, and all of that. But this is a video about how the statue turned Estonia into a cybersecurity superpower, and we have not gotten to that yet. NATO cyber expert. We have seen the statue's origin and its removal. What is missing is the fallout from the Estonian government's decision. On April 27th, while the Estonian government was ordering the statue's move, the country was the victim of one of the largest cyber operations of all time. DDoS attacks shut down the websites of parliament, government ministries, banks, and the media, among others. To this day, no one is really certain who is responsible. Sergei Markov, a member of the Russian Duma at the time, claimed that an aide working out of Transnistria unilaterally executed the attack. But that is certainly not how Estonia treated the situation. It is exactly the type of hybrid attack that the Russian government would commit. That is what plausible deniability can buy you. Either way, Estonia was not about to let such an attack happen again. And while there is no convenient time for an attack like this, the attack did occur at a relatively convenient time. You see, Estonia joined NATO in 2004. On the surface, this was to enjoy the protections of Article 5, and forever end the threat of subjugation. But part of the point of collective defense is to establish a specific role in an alliance. Do something better than everyone else, and then welcome your partners to rely on you for that specific role. 32 countries that are each experts in very specific fields can create a much stronger alliance overall than 32 countries that are individually good at everything, but masters of nothing. Given their country's geographic position, Estonian soldiers were inevitably going to be experts in frontline defense. Actually, I just came back from a visit to Estonia's Ministry of Defense, so we will have a long conversation about that soon. But frontline defense is a necessity, not an identity. By 2007, Estonia was looking to establish a center for excellence in Tallinn. This would effectively give Estonia its identity. NATO has dozens of such centers, all spearheaded by one ally, to train other allies on very specific tasks. Cold weather operations in Norway, naval mines in Belgium, IEDs in Spain, military medicine in Hungary. These all fall under the umbrella of Allied Command Transformation, the forward-looking arm of NATO headquartered in Norfolk, Virginia. Estonia, though, had not yet figured out what it could bring to the table. The cyber attacks gave Estonia a clear direction. Get good at cyber defense. No one else was leading the way at the time, so it was the perfect opportunity. Heck, the incident showed just how unprepared NATO was for such an attack, if it were to come on a grander scale. Article 4 consultations, a measure one step down from invoking Article 5, did not follow. There wasn't even a mechanism to exchange information regarding cyber attacks. And so Estonia became NATO's champion of cybersecurity, ironically placing its center of excellence less than a kilometer away from where the Bronze Soldier currently resides. Paraphrasing what an official at the Estonian Ministry of Foreign Affairs told me, they have a simple job. Make sure that when the tap turns, water comes out of the spigot. When the switch flips, the light goes on. When you press enter, the website loads. However, that expertise extends beyond Estonia's borders. That is the point of NATO's military specialization after all. And it seems that right now, Estonia is primed to be playing a bigger role than one might have imagined back in 2007. Maybe you have heard, Russia appears to be undertaking a series of covert or hybrid attacks on Europe. Heck, it seems like there is a new one every day. Well, NATO may be reaching its boiling point. Admiral Giuseppe Cavo Dragone, the chair of the NATO Military Committee, recently said that the alliance is looking into preemptive measures. Estonia's cyber expertise will likely play a role there. But the country is also a part of more regular cyber activities. Estonia now annually hosts Cyber Coalition, NATO's flagship cyber exercise. This year, 29 allied countries and 7 allied partners took part, with about 200 on-site at CR14, a facility separate from the Center of Excellence and just around the corner from the Ministry of Defense. An additional 1,100 dialed in from abroad. Yes, the joys of a cyber exercise rather than a kinetic one. I, however, was physically present for it, and what I can tell you about it is basically nothing. The fact that I cannot tell you anything, though, is what makes the whole thing interesting. But that is a longer story for another time. That is it for me for now. If you enjoyed today's video, then please like, share, and subscribe, and I will see you next time. Take care. Wait a minute. What was Ryan Macbeth doing in my shot?